The building of a cyclotron facility in Sri Lanka, I think, is, if it's not in existence now, which I'm not certain about, is vital for the production of medical isotopes. And this is something that I believe the Western powers could help out with in terms of aid rather than what they call military aid or other health aid, which is all centered on immunizations, psychiatry and antibiotics and interventional treatments. This is something that I think is a problem right throughout the what's called the third world, first world age, that's not relevant to the needs of the people of the country, but to the needs of the industries responsible. That's why I have suggested at point number 12, university-based research and education programs studying the specific health and economic problems in Sri Lanka. 20, devolution of funds for education, social services and health to rural and peripheral regions with corresponding strengthening of local government infrastructure. 21, integration of the existing public university system with a focus of development of non-divisive educational practices, including propaganda-free education in science, politics, economics and the arts, with opportunities for trilingual tertiary education in all courses. It's going to require a lot of translation of textbooks into different languages. I'm sure there'll be a lot of people who would like that work. Present company excluded, since I'm not very good at Sinhalese or Tamil. 22, a ban. This is where it's my plan at that time. Might seem a little bit either nationalistic or socialistic. I do believe that essential services should be controlled by the country or the people of the country. I'm not a big fan of capitalism, and particularly capitalism when it comes to essential services. So, you know, you can disagree with this. I'm sure many people will. A ban on foreign ownership of land in Sri Lanka. The reason for that is because of what I knew to be a proxy war that was being fought by the Tamil Tigers for landowners in what they call the Tamil diaspora, which is mainly in Canada, Australia, New Zealand, England and Europe. And these were the rich Tamils who owned land, left the country, and wanted a separate state for themselves where they would continue to be absentee landlords, I presumed. So that was one reason. The other is the danger of countries like China and America and India in particular using the territory of Sri Lanka, which is of course a very important strategic location it has, so I think it's a special situation where the Sri Lankan people really should own their own land. I suggested it in my peace plan, number 22, a ban on foreign ownership of land in Sri Lanka, and 23, long-term lease of land to foreign tenants subject to the democratic will of the Sri Lankan people by referendum. 24 and 25 are about demilitarization and programming of police, and this is 24, disarming of the police. I'm not sure if the police in Sri Lanka are armed, and the police to be trained in use of digital cameras. I believe that digital cameras are a very effective way of preventing crime. provision of digital cameras rather than guns to police officers and armed forces personnel. This is a little bit radical perhaps, but I think that the Sri Lankan people may support number 26, all guns to be banned in Sri Lanka according to the new constitution. 27, a bill of rights to be included in a new constitution. And 28, reform of the banking sector with restriction of foreign withdrawals from the country. 29, reform of the stock market. 30, abolition of free trade zones, as they're called, and prosecution of those involved in human rights abuses in such zones. 31, nationalization of electricity, water, irrigation, sewerage, and health systems. While not a total enemy of capitalism, I do believe that essential services should be controlled by a country, even at the risk of burgeoning bureaucracies, not to say corruption. But then private companies are not beyond corruption either. 32, this is where the trilingualism comes in. Change of government policy regarding languages of correspondence, with Sinhalese, Tamil and English translations provided in all forms, letters and publications by the government. 33, the formation of a National Center for Peace Studies in Colombo, Kandy and Jaffa. 34, safeguards in a new constitution to protect against discrimination on the basis of racial, linguistic, religious or political views. And 35, a new university-based publication and promotion infrastructure to market locally and internationally local literature, music, art, science and technology, historical and anthropological studies, medicine and other areas of study. 36, nationalization or decorporatization of the mining and agricultural industries. 37, a national program of vegetation or revegetation. 38, university and school-based popular scientific study and photographic documentation of existing fauna and flora in Sri Lanka. Which I'm sure have suffered as a result of the war. And 39, a national irrigation program for rural areas using renovation of existing and ancient irrigation tanks. I have a particular interest in this because my grandfather, my mother's father, Winslow Alagaratnan, was the director of irrigation, the director of the irrigation department, first under the British and after 1948 under Dudley Senanayake. And these tanks, these reservoirs, have again suffered as a result of the war. And again, something that I do believe that Western powers that claim to be helping Sri Lanka could contribute their money to renovate the very famous irrigation schemes of the ancient Sri Lankan kings. And 40, the promotion of a multicultural, multilingual national identity. So there you have it, my 40-point peace plan for Sri Lanka. Please, I'm going to post this on YouTube, on my site, so please leave a comment and let me know what you think. Thank you.